Karnataka State Park Council Law Academy. We also like to extend Deepavali festival greetings to you and your family members. Diwali's history can be traced back to ancient India with several legends associated with it. Many believe that Diwali is the celebration which marks Goddess Lakshmi's wedding with Lord Vishnu. Others believe that it's a celebration of Goddess Lakshmi's birth on a new moon day of Kartik month during the event called Samudra Manthan. Many others believe that it's a time to celebrate the victory of Lord Krishna, who killed the demon king Narakasura and rescued 16,000 women from his captivity. Among all other reasons, it mainly symbolizes the return of Lord Rama, Sita and Lakshman to Ayodhya after being exiled for 14 years. So the lighting of diyas signifies the triumph of good over evil, victory over defeat and awareness over ignorance. It is imperative that we start the journey to end the darkness within our lives and fill it with love and light. With this note, I, on behalf of the Karnataka State Bar Council Law Academy, extend my humble greetings to our esteemed and honored dignitary, Honorable Justice N. Kumar, retired judge of High Court of Karnataka. Welcome, sir. I would also like to welcome Sri Anil Kumar JM, chairman of the Karnataka State Bar Council, Sri Gautam Chand SF, president of the Karnataka State Bar Council Law Academy. I'm deliriously happy to welcome all the members of the Karnataka State Bar Council, trustees of the KSBC Law Academy, delegates, advocates, law students, and all other participants who have gathered here virtually. I request all the participants to extend your support and make your presence virtually for gracing this special occasion for the felicitation of Honorable Justice N. Kumar by the members of the Karnataka State Bar Council as a token of gratitude. So friends, feel free to post your questions or clarifications in the chat box and it will be taken up during the question and answer session. Without any further delay, I would like to welcome back our prestigious and eminent dignitary Honorable Justice N. Kumar, who will be addressing on the topic Regular Appeals under Section 96, read with Order 41 of the Civil Procedure Code 1908. Welcome, sir, and the platform is yours.
Good evening to all of you. Wish you all Deepavali greetings. Today is the last day, and today I will be dealing with right to appeal, or right of appeal. Section 96 of the Civil Procedure Code provides a right to prefer an appeal against the judgment and decree of a in a original suit. Of course, Section 100 of the Civil Procedure Code provides for a second appeal. There is also a provision for preferring miscellaneous appeals. But today's subject matter is confined to the regular appeal under Section 96 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Before we go into the details, it is necessary to know that this right of appeal is not a mere procedure. Unless a statute provides a right of appeal, nobody has a right of appeal. We saw Section 9 of the Civil Procedure Code, which said civil court has jurisdiction to try all suits of civil nature, except those which are expressly or by necessary implication barred. But when the question of appeal arises, it should be provided under a statute. Therefore, it is necessarily a statutory right. Once a statute provides for a right of appeal, the consequences is it is a substantive right. And it is a right vested in a litigant when he enters the precincts of the court, not by way of an appeal, but by way of a suit. When a person enters the precincts of a civil court by filing a suit, the Civil Procedure Code assures him, in the event of you not being satisfied with the judgment and decree passed in the original suit, you have a right of appeal. Therefore, it is a right vested in the litigant. The moment he enters the court, it is a statutory right and it is a substantive right. This is a right as it is conferred by a statute. It can be taken away only by a statute. No other person can deny this right of appeal, which is conferred under a statute. The only way it could be taken away is either abolish the forum or pass a law taking away that right. So in this background, the question arises, when a right of appeal is provided, who is the person who can prefer an appeal? Who is the person who can prefer an appeal? Any person aggrieved by a judgment and decree of a trial court has the locus standi to prefer an appeal. That is the object of providing for an appeal. That is, he must be a party to the suit and is agreed with the judgment and decree, and therefore statute gives him a right to prefer an appeal. So only the aggrieved person and aggrieved person alone who can prefer an appeal. But it so happens, during the pendency of the proceedings, the parties alienate the property. So the person who came to court during the pendency of the suit in the trial court loses his right to the property. Though in law he is expected to make good the title to the person whom he has transferred it, it so happens sometimes if the suit is lost, because he has no interest in the property, he would not prefer an appeal at all. Then the question is, what should happen to the person who purchased this property? Doctrine of dispendence says, it does not prohibit transfer of property during the pendency of a litigation. But it says that that transfer is subject to the result of the litigation. The person who transferred that property during the pendency succeeds, he gets right. He does not succeed, he loses his right. So, if a person who is a party to the proceedings, after alienating the property and loses the property, he is not interested and therefore he will not file a right appeal. In those circumstances, the alienee during the pendency of the proceedings has a right to prefer an appeal because the judgment and decree hurts him. He is aggrieved by the judgment and decree. The only thing is, if he wants to prefer an appeal, because he is not a party to the proceedings, he has to file an application seeking leave of the court to prefer an appeal. He has to file an application seeking the leave of the court, and in the affidavit accompanying the application, explain what his interest is, and then request the court to permit him to prefer an appeal. And if he is an alienee from the parties to the proceedings and the decree has gone against him, certainly the court will grant permission. But without such grant, he is not entitled to prefer an appeal. Thirdly, it so happens, once the case is posted for judgment after hearing the arguments, during that interregnum period, one of the party dies. The law is very clear. Once the argument is over and the case is posted for judgment, the court can proceed to pass the judgment. And even though on the date of the judgment, the person is dead, that judgment and decree is not a nullity because it has been completely heard. It also happens after the decree, there's a 30 days time for preferring an appeal. During that period, the party dies who has suffered the decree. So question is, in those circumstances, who is the person who is has right to prefer an appeal? Normally, his legal heirs, legal representatives. So even they are not parties to the proceedings. They are not brought on record. And therefore, the law expects them to file an application again, explaining the circumstances, and seek the leave of the court and prefer an appeal. And normally the courts grant such permission. Therefore, three persons could be said to be the persons who are competent to prefer an appeal, who has the right to prefer appeal. One, party to the proceedings, who is agreed with the judgment and decree. An alienee from the party to the proceedings, who has interest is affected by the judgment and decree. And legal representative of the persons of the deceased who died after the case is reserved for judgment, or after the judgment before the appeal time is over, he also has the right to prefer an appeal. So this is an aspect which the members of the bar should keep in mind. Now, it is in this background, let us see what the statutory provision as contained in section 96 of the Civil Procedure Code provides for. Section 96 says it is appeal from original decree. So that's the word. There may be an original decree or an appellate decree. An appeal from an appellate decree lies to the High Court under Section 100. An appeal from the original decree passed by the trial court lies to the first appellate court. Save where otherwise expressly provided in the body of this code or by any other law for the time being in force, an appeal shall lie from every decree. An appeal shall lie from every decree passed by any court exercising original jurisdiction. Decree passed by a court exercising original jurisdiction to the court authorized to hear appeals from the decision of such court. So here are three important things. One, it provides for an appeal against a decree, and that decree should have been passed by the original court, the original court exercising the original jurisdiction. And then appeal lies to the court authorized to hear appeals. It is the Karnataka Civil Courts Act which provides for this appellate forum, in the sense which is the court authorized to hear the appeal. So therefore, if a judgment decree is passed by the civil judge, an appeal lies under Section 96 to the Civil Judge Senior Division Court. If a Civil Judge Senior Division has passed the original decree and the subject matter of the suit is less than 10 lakhs, an appeal lies straight to the District Court. If the subject matter of the suit is more than 10 lakhs, the first appeal lies to the High Court. This is an aspect which you have to be clear about it, and it is provided for in the Karnataka Civil Courts Act. Now, we have seen who has the right to prefer and how the appeal is filed. Subsection 2 of Section 96 speaks about an instance where an appeal may lie from an original decree passed ex parte. One is speaking about a decree passed after contest. It's a contested decree. It is possible that there may be no contest at all. As a suit is decreed ex parte, there is no contest. Now the question is whether an appeal lies against that decree. Subsection 2 of Section 96 expressly states an appeal may lie from an original decree passed ex parte. So contested decree, appeal lies. Ex parte decree, appeal lies. Now the question arises, when an ex parte decree is passed, what are the remedies available to the party? All of you are aware, when an ex parte decree is passed, Order 9, Rule 13 of the Civil Procedure Code provides for an application being filed to the very same court which passed the decree, seeking setting aside of the decree on the ground that the defendant was prevented by sufficient cause from appearing before the court. And if the court is satisfied, it can set aside the decree, restore the suit, permit the defendant to contest the matter, and then after contest, pass a decree. Now the question is, when such a remedy is available to a party, instead of availing that remedy, can he prefer an appeal under Section 96? Can the appellate court can exercise the same jurisdiction which the trial court could have done? In law, normally, if you have a grievance, only one remedy is provided. Is special procedure, civil procedure code in special law, is it giving them a double remedies? It is very clear, especially I want the younger members of the bar to know, though civil procedure code provides for two remedies, they have their own limitations. If you prefer an appeal under Section 96, it's an ex parte decree. If you were to argue that you had a sufficient cause from non-appearance on the day the decree was passed, that court will say, appellate court will say, then go under Order 9, Rule 13. That is not my jurisdiction. If that is so, what is the object of providing this appeal? There are instances where the suit is not maintainable. The court should have applied its mind. Defendant did not appear, and the court casually has passed a decree. We saw under Section 9, maybe it's a civil case, it is a civil court. There may be an express or implication, the suit is barred. Court did not notice it. Plaintiff did not bring it to the notice. Defendant was absent, therefore he did not bring it to the notice. It is possible that the court may pass a decree in a case where it had no jurisdiction. In other words, suit itself was not maintainable. Then we have Order 7, Rule 11. We saw it If the plaintiff does not disclose cause of action, if there's a bar under any law for the maintenance of the suit, written statement is not to be looked into. No cross-examination. The suit can be dismissed. Therefore, a defendant who has suffered a decree without filing statement, without leading evidence, if he is so confident that he will be able to persuade and convince the appellate court that the suit is not maintainable, plaintiff does not disclose any cause of action, court below did not have jurisdiction, and for example, take a case of specific performance. Section 16 of the Specific Relief Act says the court to get jurisdiction to pass a decree for specific performance, the legal requirement to be complied with is the party who wants the relief should plead and prove that he was ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. Because there was no written statement. Because this vendor, suppose plea is there, but no proof is there. Now the defendant in the appeal says, look at the case. This is the plea. Where is the evidence? There is no evidence. And therefore the trial court committed a mistake in decreeing the suit. Because there's a jurisdictional point. The court could not have exercised the jurisdiction to grant a decree for specific performance in the absence of convincing proof of the plea of specific performance. If he's confident, he could argue the matter and get the suit dismissed. That is, appeal is allowed, suit is dismissed. But in that appeal, the argument that he was sufficient, they were prevented from sufficient cause in appearing the court on the day the decree was passed is not maintainable. So please note this distinction and be careful about what your ground of appeal. Having said the contested matter and in the ex parte decree and appeal lies, the law is very clear that no appeal shall lie from a decree passed by the court with the consent of the parties. Consent decree, no appeal. Contested decree, appeal lies. Ex parte decree, appeal lies. So this distinction, a lawyer who wants to prefer an appeal should bear in mind. Now, the most important thing is, what is a decree is defined under the Civil Procedure Code. Decree means the formal expression of an adjudication, which so far as regards the court expressing it, conclusively determines the rights of the parties with regard to all or any of the matters in controversy in the suit, and may be either preliminary or final. It shall be deemed to include the rejection of applying and the determination of any question within the section 144, but shall not include an adjudication from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order or any order of dismissal for default. This is what the definition of decree as provided in the Civil Procedure Code. Now, it speaks about a preliminary or a final decree. What is the preliminary decree? What is the final decree? The explanation to this clearly says, a decree is preliminary when further proceedings have to be taken before the suit can be completely disposed of. It is final when such adjudication completely disposes of the suit. It may be partly preliminary and partly final. Insofar as Section 96 is concerned, if it is a decree passed by a court of original jurisdiction, an appeal lies. Against a preliminary decree also appeal lies. Against a final decree also appeal lies. This is an aspect which the lawyer should bear in mind. In partition suit in particular, there are two decrees. In the preliminary decree, the court declared the rights of the parties against which an appeal lies under Section 96, against which an appeal lies under Section 100 to the High Court, against which you can also approach the Supreme Court by way of special leave petition. Once that final preliminary decree attains finality, then final decree proceedings are initiated. Again, against the final decree, an appeal lies to the under Section 96, and against that appellate decree, an appeal lies to the High Court under Section 100, and then a special leave petition. So, therefore, there are instances where a preliminary decree is passed. There is a mistake in the preliminary decree. Party does not want to prefer an appeal. He's fed up. So he will not file an appeal. person aggrieved does not file appeal. It reaches finality. It happens in partition suit because he was claiming half share, he is given 1/3 share. He was claiming 1/4 share, he is given 1/8 share, whatever it may be. He is fed up and he doesn't want to prefer an appeal. Then that preliminary decree, on the basis of preliminary decree, final decree proceedings are initiated. The mistake in the preliminary decree will be followed in the final decree. It can't be different. Final decree should be based on preliminary decree. Then probably he opens his eyes. He wants to prefer an appeal against the final decree because the law provides for it. So he prefers an appeal against the final decree to the under section 96 to the appellate court. Now the question is, when the appellate court is seized of the correctness of the final decree, is it open to the party to now argue that there was a mistake in the preliminary decree? Even if he argues whether the court has the jurisdiction to set aside, though the error is apparent. 97 of the Civil Procedure Code categorically states court has no jurisdiction to touch the preliminary decree, which has become final, even if it is erroneous. Section 97 says, where any party aggrieved by a preliminary decree passed after the commencement of this court does not appeal from such decree, he shall be precluded from disputing its correctness in any appeal which may be preferred from the final decree. Therefore, the lawyer should be very careful while advising and while taking a decision to prefer an appeal. If there is an error in the preliminary decree, that should be set right by filing an appeal against the decree. You cannot get that error set aside when you prefer an appeal against the final decree. There's another aspect which you should bear in mind. Is this is called as doctrine of merger. You don't find it in the Civil Procedure Code, but it is accepted. When an appeal is filed in the appellate court, reverses, it can reverse the judgment. It can modify the judgment. It can affirm the decree of the trial court. Then there's a judgment of the trial court. There's a judgment of the first appellate court. And against which an appeal is filed, there will be judgment of the second high court. So in one case, you have three judgments, you have three decrees. The question is, how do you look at these things? In law, is there any really three decrees and three judgments? Answer is no. That is the doctrine of merger. When an appeal is filed and the appellate court passes a judgment, the trial court judgment and decree merges with the first appellate court. And if a second appeal is there, the judgment and decree of the trial court, the judgment and decree of the first appellate court merges with the decree of the second appeal. So in law, there is only one judgment and decree, though physically there are three judgments and decree. It so happens after the judgment and decree is passed by the high court, you try to execute. When you try to execute, you'll have problems. What is the problem? The name of the party, there is a mistake. Survey number, there is a mistake. Property number, there is a mistake. There's a mistake in the measurement. There's a mistake in the boundary. Unless you correct it, it is not possible to execute. Law provides for correction. 152, 153, even inherent jurisdiction. An amendment is to be carried out. So where do you file that application? You file it in the trial court. If the trial court has the jurisdiction to entertain the application and correct a judgment, decree, or even the pleadings after the entire litigation is over, the answer is no. Once the decree merges with the appellate court decree and both the decrees merges with the second appellate court, these courts lose their jurisdiction to touch those decrees. If you want any amendment, if you want any correction, that application is to be filed only in the court, the final court. This is called as doctrine of merger, which is provided under 152 and 153. 152 of the Civil Procedure Code talks about amendment of judgments, decrees or orders. It says clerical or arithmetical mistakes in judgments, decrees or orders, or errors arising therein from accidental slip or omission may at any time be corrected by the court, either of its own motion or in the application of any of the parties. Court has the power. Which is the court is the question. 153 says, the court may at any time and on such terms as to cause or otherwise, as it thinks fit, amend any defect or error in any proceeding in a sort and all necessary amendments shall be made of the purpose of determining the real question or issues raised by or depending on such proceedings. Power lies in the court. The question is which court, and that court is the final court and not the original court. Now, yesterday somebody put a question about the law says one preliminary decree, one final decree, and a decree may be partly preliminary and partly final. So is there any scope for more than one preliminary decree? Civil procedure code do not provide for it. But a judgment of the Supreme Court laying down the law in this aspect under Article 141 of the Constitution of India is in force in this country, because it is a law declared by the Supreme Court under Article 141. It is binding on all courts. So what do they say? They say this is a judgment in the case of Phool Chand versus Gopal Lal, EIR 1967 Supreme Court, page 1470. Phool Chand versus Gopal Lal, 1967 Supreme Court, page 1470. The Supreme Court has declared the law, which according to me would be very, very useful today in the light of amendment to the Hindu Succession Act, incorporating the new Section 6. Supreme Court said in this judgment, we are of the opinion that there is nothing in the Code of Civil Procedure which prohibits the passing of more than one preliminary decree if circumstances justify the same, and that it may be necessary to do so, particularly in partition suits, when after preliminary decree, some parties die and shares of other parties are thereby augmented. That is Hindu law, copartitionary property, joint family property, inheritance by survivorship, devolution of interest by survivorship. In a copartitionary property, if one copartitioner dies, the share of the other copartitioners get increased. If a child, therefore, is it necessary to file one more suit to claim that share? Supreme Court said, no, even if a preliminary decree is passed, after the preliminary decree, one of the sharer dies, mother, father, brother, their shares goes to the others by survivorship, and by passing one more preliminary decree, you can avoid a litigation. So this is only confined to what is called as partition suits. Now they said death. After said that, in another para, this is what they said. So far, therefore, as partition suits are concerned, so especially for partition suits, we have no doubt that if event transpires, there they use the word, if an event transpires, death is also one of the event. Amendment to the law is also one of the event. If an event transpires after the preliminary decree, which necessitates a changes in shares, the court can and should do so. And if there's a dispute in that behalf, the order of the court deciding the dispute and making variation in shares specified in the preliminary decree already passed in a decree in itself, which would be liable to appeal. So if an event happens now in our country, by 2005 amendment, daughter has been treated as a copartitioner, and therefore she is entitled to an equal share with that of the son. Till such time, her share was not equal. She had a share, her share was not equal. Now, if a preliminary decree is passed, giving her a lesser share because of the law on that day, by subsequent amendment, when her right is enlarged, there could be one more preliminary decree in terms of the change in the law, and it is permitted by virtue of this section, the judgment rendered under Section 141 of the Constitution of India. Now, this is an aspect which I'm sure the lawyers should know, and you will have ample opportunity to make use of the judgment and see that justice is done to those persons. This is about the scope of an appeal under Section 96. In fact, it is like a substantial law in the CPC itself. The procedural aspects are found in Article in Order 41. Order 41, Rule 1 specifically says forum of appeal. What is the forum in which an appeal is to be filed? And what to accompany the memorandum of appeal? These are all provisions which are there in the CPC from 1908. Only thing is we have to see and understand it properly. It says every appeal shall be preferred in the form of a memorandum signed by the appellant or his pleader or presented to the court or to such officer as it appoints in his behalf. The memorandum shall be accompanied by a copy of the judgment. Section 96 said, appeal lies against a decree. No mention of judgment. Here, in the earlier it was decree. Now the decree is omitted and in place judgment is done. Inserted. Why? It is our practice. We have more than 100 years of case law on that point. Judgment is passed by the judge. Then he will direct the office to draw up a decree in terms of the judgment. The judgment is to be drawn up by the decree branch office, the clerk, within 15 days. It so happens, even after 6 months, you don't get the decree because the decree branch, there was one clerk. He is transferred. No one is posted there. If she is a lady, she has gone for maternity leave. She will come only after 6 months. And that post is kept vacant. And nobody else knows how to draw up a decree. But here is a man who has suffered a decree and he wants to prepare an appeal. So this was the position which was prevailing. And now in the recent amendments, they understood the problem and they said, if you want to prefer an appeal, don't wait for the decree. You can prefer an appeal against the judgment. That change in the law, you must bear in mind. Only for the purpose of preferring the appeal, the judgment is treated as a decree. But that judgment cannot be put into execution unless a decree is drawn, and only through decree you can execute the decree. This is an aspect which you should bear in mind. Now, what is more important according to me? They said an appeal shall be filed in the form of a memorandum. What is that memorandum? What should be its contents? Is also explained in the CPC. And hardly this provision is, we saw Article 6, how we are playing should be. Law says something, we are doing something else. Similarly, the law says how should be a memorandum and we are doing something else. Please see what it says. The memorandum shall set forth, that is, memorandum of appeal shall set forth, see the words concisely, and under distinct heads, the grounds of objection to the decree appealed from, without any argument or narrative, and such grounds shall be numbered consecutively. CPC also said there should not be any evidence, only plea, Order 6. Here they say, don't put in an argument that you argue before the judge. Don't have a narrative, don't go on stating what the case is. Here is a judgment and decree, go through it, say where what is the error committed by them. If you want to highlight it, make it as a ground, title, possession, limitation, maintainability, then elaborate the ground. But we see in real life, 20 grounds, 30 grounds, 40 grounds, and none of the grounds. If there are more than 3 or 4 grounds, that means there is no substance in the appeal. You need not be afraid. See, you should know what the case is. You should know where to hit it. Simply by adding pages and grounds, the case doesn't get strengthened. Please, it's time that we should disband such procedures. 20 grounds, 30 grounds, 40 grounds. And you don't argue it also, because you don't know what is written there also. You will argue only one ground or two grounds in an appeal. Anyhow, this is the practice. So therefore, contents of the memorandum of appeal is also specifically provided in the CPC. And we must respect the law. We must try to keep it within the four corners of law. And further, the CPC says, if you have not raised a ground, you cannot argue that ground. Assuming by mistake you have not raised the ground, you want to add additional ground, you can do so with the leave of the court. As the court is concerned, it has to decide the case on merits. And if there is a ground which is not taken by both the parties, it can decide the case on that ground. The only limitation is, please bring it to the notice of the parties, what you feel, hear them, satisfy the principle of natural justice, then the appeal could be disposed of on that ground which is not argued by both the parties. Sometimes it do happen. Now, when an appeal is filed, normally, there's a limitation. If the appeal is not filed within limitation, Order 41, Rule 3, capital A, which is in parameter area of Section 5 of the Limitation Act, provides for an application being filed for condoning the delay in filing the appeal. This is an amendment. Earlier, we used to invoke Section 5. Now, Order 41, Rule 3A deals with that. It says, when an appeal is presented, after the expiry of the period of limitation specified, therefore, it shall be accompanied by an application supported by affidavit, setting forth the facts on which the appellant relies to satisfy the court that he has sufficient cause for not preferring the appeal within such period. So a provision is made for condonation of delay. All that you have to do is to file an application, and the reasons you give it in the affidavit, file it along with the memorandum of appeal. If the court sees no reason to reject the application without the issue of notice to the respondent, notice thereof shall be issued to the respondent, and the matter shall be finally decided by the court before it proceeds to deal with the appeal under Rule 11 or Rule 13, as the case may be. That is the importance. Unless the application for condonation of delay is considered, delay is condoned, in law there is no appeal before the appellate court. Appellate court can't touch that appeal. Appellate court can't pass any other order in that appeal. As long as delay is there, in law there is no appeal. Physically, appeal memo is there, IA is there, but in law you have to consider only the appeal memo and not the appeal. And further, subsection 3 says, where an application has been made under subrule 1, the court shall not make any order for the stay of execution of the decree against which the appeal is proposed to be filed, so long as the court does not, after hearing under Rule 11, decide to hear the appeal. Normally, appeal memo is filed, condonation of delay application is filed, stay application is filed. Now, this clearly says when these things have to be heard. First, you must hear the application for condoning the delay. Without condoning the delay, you cannot consider the application for stay. Now, condonation of delay is allowed, then you cannot hear the application for stay. The next stage is, you must hear the application for admission. Only if the court feels that the appeal is like to be admitted, admit the appeal, and then consider the application for stay. Well, you know it better than me how it is allowed, but this is the law. So, insofar as considering the application for stay, court has the power to grant stay, but that power has to be exercised with caution, and there are limitations imposed on the power of the court. And what is the effect of an appeal being filed and no stay being there? And what is the effect of stay being granted? Also clearly set out. Because earlier, appeal used to be filed and then no stay. In the trial court, an application is, memo is filed saying, I have filed an appeal. You wait till the appeal is disposed of. You can't proceed. So hearing all this, this section is now properly framed. What is it? An appeal shall not operate as a stay of the proceedings under a decree or order appealed from. So mere filing of an appeal, it does not operate as a stay of the judgment and decree. When does it stay? Except so far as the appellate court may order, there should be an express order of stay to be passed by the appellate court for the decree to be stayed. Otherwise, mere filing of the appeal is not tantamount to stay of an order. Nor shall execution of a decree be stayed. There is no prohibition. Decree can be executed by reason only of an appeal having been preferred from the decree. But the appellate court may, for sufficient cause, order stay of execution of such decree. So therefore, appellate court has the power, but before the appellate court exercise this power of stay, it must ensure that there is no delay. If there is a delay, delay is condoned, then appeal is admitted, then consider this application for stay subject to the condition that sufficient cause is shown for that order. What here the learned members of the bar should know is, the power the appellate court can exercise to grant stay, same power is vested with the court which passed the decree also. where an application is made for stay of execution of an appealable decree before the expiration of the time allowed for appealing therefrom, the court which passed the decree, may on sufficient cause being shown, order the execution to be stayed. Though there is a time, 30 days, if it is the appellate court, 90 days to the high court, we have to collect the papers, we have to do so many things, but the order passed by the decree starts operating the next day. In the very same court, you can make an application. Say, I'm preferring an appeal. These are the difficulties. And please stay the decree which you have passed. And the court which passed the decree has the jurisdiction to stay its own decree for a limited period. Of course, the law says, mere making out sufficient cause is not sufficient for the court to grant power to grant a stay. What more requires to be done? It is very clear. No order for stay of execution shall be made under subrule 1 or subrule 2 unless the court making it is satisfied. First, you have to make out sufficient cause, and then you must make out that substantial loss may result to the party applying for stay of execution unless the order is made. So substantial loss should be shown. Then secondly, that the application has been made without unreasonable delay. If it's going to cause you substantial loss, you must approach the court immediately. You can't slip over the matter. Courts are not meant for people who are slipping over the matter. You must approach the court at the earliest point of time and see that security has been given by the applicant or due performance of the decree or order as may ultimately be binding upon him. You are all great. Judges are very liberally granting stay without insisting on that. Enjoy that benefit. Now, this is how an application for stay of the judgment and decree of the trial court could be obtained by making an application well in advance, in time, without delay, and pointing out the substantial loss and the fact that you intend to prefer an appeal and also mentioning the defect there. So this is how a lawyer who prefers an appeal should bear in mind these three aspects and see that the requirement of law is met, and therefore the appeal is filed in time and considered by the court. I do not propose to take the stage of admission because there is a controversy. Let us go into the question of a very important thing which you have to come across is this. It so happens after a decree is passed, the court may pass a decree as prayed for. The court may dismiss the suit, or the court may partially decree the suit. In the case of partial decrees, a portion of the decree is in favor of the plaintiff, a portion of the decree is against him. So then what happens? The plaintiff has a right to prefer an appeal under section 96 against that portion of the decree which is against him. It so happens sometimes he is tired. In income tax law, they call it as purchasing peace. He said, I committed a mistake in coming to the court. I have spent my life. I have lost my money. All right, I got something. Let me keep quiet. I don't want to go to court again. I will not challenge it. I'll accept it. It is out of frustration. He doesn't prefer an appeal against that portion of the decree. But the defendant who has suffered a decree, quite partially, he will prefer an appeal. Once he prefers an appeal, notice will go to this man. A person was fed up with the court, he did not come to court. Poor fellow, he did not choose that portion of the decree, even though he had a case. But that peace of mind is lost because the other man has gone to court, notice has come. Now he has to contest. So once he has to contest, then he will start applying his mind. Why can't I challenge that portion of the decree which is against me? By that time, limitation is over. And what is the cost shown? So therefore, in those circumstances, the law comes to his rescue. Law comes to his rescue and gives him an opportunity to prefer an appeal against that portion of the decree, which is known as cross objection. That is contained in Order 41, Rule 22. So every lawyer should bear this in mind. If there's a partial decree, And if your client has not preferred an appeal because you are disgusted, but if the other man invites him to court, then you can open your eyes, exercise this right, which is conferred under Order 41, Rule 22, and prefer an appeal against that portion of the decree which is against you. Apart from that, the latest amendments, some more rights are given to that person. What are those rights? Now, please be clear, because there is a lot of confusion in this. One, when the defendant prefers an appeal, the plaintiff who has succeeded partially, for him to defend the decree, he need not prefer an appeal. All that he has to do is stand up and argue the matter. That's the end of the matter. So to defend the appeal, he can argue. That is one such right conferred. Second, it so happens sometimes there are several issues framed in a case. One of the issues is held against the plaintiff. But having regard to the finding recorded on other issues, he succeeds. Now the law is, we saw under Section 96, only a person who is aggrieved by a judgment and decree may prefer an appeal. Now, because he has succeeded in the suit and decree is passed, though a finding and an issue is against him, he cannot prefer an appeal under Section 96 because he is not an aggrieved person. Judgment is in his favor. So when the defendant prefers an appeal, he gets an opportunity not only to defend the judgment and decree, he can also argue before the appellate court and say the finding of that particular issue which is against him is incorrect, and that finding is to be set aside, and that finding should be in his favor. That is another right which this provision gives to a defendant. And the third right which is given is, he can prefer a cross objection against that portion of the judgment which is against him within 30 days from the date of service of notice of the said appeal. And the effect of such cross objection is, it is a cross appeal. All the rules which are applicable to an appeal under Section 96, read with Order 43, Rule 1, equally applies to this cross objection filed within 30 days from the date of service of notice in the appeal. So this is the sum and substance of this particular provision. Now, this provision also provides for a cross objection being filed against a finding which is against him. He cannot prefer an appeal under Section 96. Nowhere he can file a cross objection. The effect of cross objection is, if the appeal is withdrawn, if the appeal is dismissed for default, if cross objection is not filed, the defendant, where will he argue? Appeal is not there, so he has to keep quiet. But if he has filed a cross objection challenging a finding, if he has filed a cross objection challenging that portion of the decree against him, even if the appeal is withdrawn, even if the appeal is dismissed for default, this cross objection is treated as an independent appeal, and the appellate court is bound to decide that appeal on merits. And that's how his interest is protected. So see this provision. Any respondent, though he may not have appealed from any part of the decree, may not only support the decree, but may also state that the finding against him in the court below in respect to the issue ought to have been in his favor, and may also take any cross objection to the decree which he could have taken by way of appeal, provided he has filed such objection in the appellate court within 1 month from the date of service on him or his pleader of notice of the day fixed for hearing of the appeal, or within such further time as the appellate court may see fit to allow. So these are the three rights which are conferred on the defendant. Therefore, this is an area where a lot of confusion. Our judges will dismiss saying that you have not filed a cross objection. Without filing a cross objection, you can challenge a finding. He may support the decree. He may also contend that the decree finding on any issue is erroneous and should be in his favor. He can challenge that portion of the decree by filing a cross objection. And if he has filed a cross objection challenging the finding, even if the appeal is withdrawn, the court is bound to look into that finding and if he is able to convince him, that finding will be reversed. So therefore, this is a provision which should be borne in mind by especially the counsel appearing the respondent, because this is what you are expected to advise to the client. He will not be knowing it. Now, in addition to this, you will have a opportunity to what is known as set right the injustice done, if at all, by what is called as production of additional evidence in appellate court. If there is some lacuna, if there is some vacuum, and you have better evidence that is not produced in the trial court, there's no point in your blaming the judge. If that evidence was there, probably it would not have passed the judgment. Therefore, the law provides for it. Though the law is amended, saying all documents should be filed along with the pleadings and subsequently no document will be received except with the leave of the court, the corresponding provision was not amended in the appellate court. There's a reason for that. What is the reason? Carefully read this provision. Production of additional evidence in the appellate court. So it specifically speaks about production of additional evidence in the appellate court. It says, the parties to an appeal shall not be entitled to produce. Please see the words. The parties to the appeal shall not be entitled to produce additional evidence, whether oral or documentary, in the appellate court. That's the law. You have no right to produce additional evidence. Whether oral evidence or documentary evidence, you cannot produce. After stating this law, a small exception is made. It is, but if the court from whose decree the appeal is preferred has refused to admit evidence which ought to have been admitted. Yesterday, we were discussing about that. There is what is called objection to marking, objection to production. An objection is taken. The judge refused to admit the document. The document is in the file. And because the document was not produced, the court was not looked into, you lost the battle. Now you have preferred an appeal. And your grievance is the judge was not right in refusing to admit that evidence. If that document had been looked into, the judgment would have been different. So if that is the case, in the appellate court, you can make an application as far as the document is concerned is already on record and request the court to look into the document, provided you make out a case for admission of that evidence. You make out a case that the trial judge was in error in refusing to admit this document. Two, the party seeking to produce additional evidence establishes that notwithstanding the exercise of due diligence, such evidence was not within his knowledge or could not, after the exercise of due diligence, be produced by him at the time when the decree appealed against was passed. So, if you are able to make out the case that I was not aware of this document at all, or with due diligence I could not lay my hands on this, and if that document is required for the decision of the case, you can make a request, and the court is convinced that document also could be produced at the appellate stage for the first time. Thirdly, this is an important point. There you have no role to play. It is for the court. The appellate court requires, not the parties, court requires any document to be produced or any witness to be examined to enable it to pronounce judgment or for any other substantial cause, the appellate court may allow such evidence or document to be produced or witness to be examined. So absolute power is conferred on the appellate court to call upon some evidence which the court wants to do justice between the parties. In the end of the day, what you do is one thing. Ultimately, it is the courts which have to do justice. And therefore, the law is very clear. In these circumstances, the additional evidence could be entertained by the appellate court and on an application filed by it. Here, let me pause for a moment. This is what the civil procedure course is. Over the year, we have developed the law. Earlier, what used to happen was, in the appellate court, an application was filed for amendment of the pleadings. Application is filed for appointment of a commissioner. an application is filed for appointment of a handwriting expert, forensic expert. Once an appeal is filed and a stay order is obtained, one after another application is filed, objection, argument, order, and if the order goes against you, file it revision, get the better stay. So there were all the cause for delay in disposal of an appeal also. Therefore, now both the High Court and the Supreme Court has categorically stated what should be the procedure of the appellate court, what a lawyer is expected to do, what the judge is expected to do. Now, the application to bring the LRs on record, application for conditional delay, application for stay, or the applications to be heard as and when it is filed. It cannot be postponed. But all other applications filed should not be heard independently. All the applications should be heard along with the appeal on merits. While hearing the appeal, if the party is able to make out a case for allowing that application, then the court will not pass the judgment and decree. It will allow the application, follow the procedure, and then again hear the appeal on merits and decide the case. So therefore, today, as the law stands, except these applications, the question of hearing any other application would not arise. You have a right to file an application. Other side has a right to file objection. After the objections are filed, that application should be heard along with the appeal on merits and not independently. So that unnecessarily the challenge is made to those orders and the progress of the appeal on merits is stayed by the appellate court. So the lawyer should bear in mind, there's no point in fighting with the judge saying, no, you argue, you have filed an application, you argue, pass an order. If you I'm agreed, I'll go to the High Court. All that will not happen. Now, Supreme Court and the High Courts have consistently taken the view. All these applications have been heard along with the appeal on merits. And therefore, question of hearing those applications independently during the pendency of the appeal does not arise. So therefore, these are some of the aspects which a lawyer appearing in the appellate court and challenging the appellate judgment and decree has to bear in mind. Now, let me tell you in a nutshell, no judgment delivered by any court would be 100% correct because it's a human being. At the same time, any mistake is not a good ground for setting aside the judgment and decree. The mistake you are pointing out should be of a substantial nature. Any mistakes committed by the judge, we do not go to the root of the matter. We do not touch upon the jurisdiction. We do not touch upon the merits of the case. Cannot be made a ground for setting aside the judgment and decree of a trial court. You may ask me, where do you get it? That's the law. Unfortunately, neither judges nor lawyers have looked into it, though it is expressly provided in the Civil Procedure Code. Please see section 99 and 99A. And therefore, when you argue, you must bear in this mind and you should not waste your energy, but you must be concentrating on real substance rather than technicalities. Section 99 says, no decree to be reversed or modified for error or irregularity not affecting merits or jurisdiction. This is the law. No decree shall be reversed or substantially varied, nor shall any case be remanded in appeal on account of any misjoinder or not disjoinder of parties or causes of action or any error, defect or irregularity in any proceedings in the suit, not affecting the merits of the case or the jurisdiction of the court. This is as far as suit is concerned. On the execution side, 99A says, no order under section 47 to be reversed or modified unless decision of the case is prejudicially affected. Therefore, when you are arguing an appeal, this you have to bear in mind and you must go to the matter in issue directly, because no issues are framed. Order 41, Rule 33 of the Civil Procedure Code says how an appellate court judgment should be. As yesterday I said, law does not say how the judgment of the trial court should be. But the appellate court judgment, the law says. It says they must formulate the points for consideration, they must give reasons, then they must record a finding. This points for consideration is framed by the judges after the case is reserved for judgment and when they are dictating the judgment. You will never know what is the point for consideration. Therefore, my appeal to the members of the bar is assist the judges. When you stand up to argue the matter, please give him a brief description and then tell him this is the defect in the judgment and this is the point I want to argue. So if you say this is the point for me to canvass, the judge could formulate the point for consideration then and there so that you know what is the point for consideration. He also knows what is the point for consideration. The opposite side also knows the point for consideration. Though it is not there in the civil procedure court, I would say to do justice between the parties, as lawyer is an office of the court, judge is an officer, if you agree, what is the point that arises for consideration? Put it in writing, formulate it, argue on that basis so that the attention of everyone will be on that point and you could expect justice in that case. And you will also have the satisfaction. You have also contributed to the cause of justice. Once that points for consideration is formulated, you can concentrate your argument on that point. Other side also will concentrate. Judge also is in clear. He can say, this is the point for consideration. This is the argument of the learned counsel. This is the material on record. This is my finding. So an appellate judge who has experience in the field would be able to do better justice. So time is up. Thank you for all the advocates and the law students who have patiently heard me for 9 days. And it was a great experience. And I must thank the Karnataka State Bar Council for giving this opportunity to a retired judge without forgetting even after 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us and sharing your profound knowledge. Progressing towards the question and answer session, I now request Professor Dr. V. Sudesh, former Dean and Principal of ULC, to take over the question and answer session. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, sir, and thank you so much. 9 days, I don't know how it has gone, but truly, the following days of Deepavali would really mean the word Deepavali because we are entering the festival mode with all the knowledge of light that you have thrown on CPC, sir. So today there may be some questions which may not be relevant from today's lecture point of view, but since this is the last occasion for some of them, I request humbly, sir, if you can please clarify the question, the answers to those questions, sir. So the question number one, yes, sir, thank you, sir.
I'll make an attempt,
thank you, sir. Question is, conflict between Section 28 of Specific Relief Act and Section 148 and 151 of CPC. Which one would prevail?
Section 28 is a substantial provision. The other provisions are procedural provisions. The substantial provision should prevail over those provisions.
Whether a trespasser who is in possession of a land for a number of years can file a suit for permanent injunction if there is a threat of possession.
Though he was a trespasser, if he has continued in possession, in law, it is recognized as settled possession. In law, it is recognized as settled possession. If he is in settled possession, though it is illegal, the law of the land as on today is, he is entitled to protect his possession.
Next question is, sir, before filing an appeal, plaintiff dies. Can the legal representatives of the plaintiff prefer an appeal who are actually not brought on record in the original suit?
That's precisely what I said. They have a right to prefer an appeal. They are not parties to the proceedings. And the person who is a party to the proceedings died before appeal is filed. They can file an LR application and also file an application seeking leave of the court to permit them to prefer an appeal. And such a request is made, certainly it will be granted.
The next question is, can a contractual agreement not to appeal supersede the CPC or the latter will prevail?
Law will prevail over that agreement. That law is contrary to public policy, contrary to law. Therefore, it's hit by Section 23.
The next question is, sir, what is the procedure to file additional documents for the grounds already implemented in a writ petition pending before the High Court, is it sufficient to file a memo along with the additional documents, or should we file an IA for filing additional documents? What is the law governing this aspect, sir?
It all depends upon the judge who is hearing the matter. If it's too technical, he will say file an application. If you want to overcome all these procedural technicalities and want to do justice, you may receive it by a memo also. There is no law. Normally, writ petitions are above all this law. Sky is the limit as far as the power of the court is concerned. Normally, civil procedure code is also applied. It all depends upon the facts of the case, the judge who is hearing the matter, and the stage at which the matter is heard.
Can an execution petition filed after the limitation period is over? Can Section 5 of the Limitation Act condone the execution petitions?
It won't. Section 5 application has no application to an execution petition.
Thank you.
Once 20 years is over, it's gone.
Fine. Sir, whether it's mandatory to file written cross objection for respondent to seek any issues, it has to be reversed from that of finding given in original suit?
That's what I said it. Without filing a cross objection, the defendant can argue that a finding which is recorded against him is erroneous. No cross objection need be filed. He has a right. But no opportunity is also given to him to file a cross objection challenging that finding, though he has no right of appeal. If he exercises that right, even if the appeal is withdrawn, appeal is dismissed for default, this cross objection has to be heard on merits by the court and pass an order.
During the pendency of an appeal or revision before the High Court, can a party seek an amendment under Section 152 over a clerical mistake before the trial court? Then, is it necessary for the trial court to dispose the amendment application first, or can the appellate court proceed to dispose the appeal or revision, ignoring the pending amendment by the trial court?
If the doctrine of merger is not applicable, if the doctrine of merger is applicable, application will be filed in the appellate court. If the appeal is not yet decided, the matter is before the appellate court. The trial court cannot touch it. He has to wait.
Fine.
Once it has gone out and it is sub judice, matter before the appellate court, it cannot do anything which will in any way affect the jurisdiction of the appellate court.
Sir, when a preliminary decree is not challenged but not agree with the final decree for allotment of property, then that final decree can be challenged?
Against a final decree, an appeal lies. But in that appeal against the final decree, what you have to look into is the correctness of the finding in the final decree. The correctness of the finding in the preliminary decree cannot be gone into. Both against preliminary decree and final decree, appeal lies.
Fine, sir. Sir, in a regular appeal, the appellant is not appearing and the respondent appears. Can the regular appeal be dismissed for non-prosecution? What are the consequences for the appellant?
Like the suit, if the appellant does not appear, the appellate court has the jurisdiction to dismiss the appeal for default, non-prosecution. Similarly, if the appellant files an application to recall that order, setting out the cause, a sufficient cause for non-appearance of the day it was dismissed, the court has the right to recall the order and restore the appeal and decide the appeal on merits.
Whether an appeal in the courts other than the High Court and or the Supreme Court needs to be admitted, as there is no such stage in these courts.
The understanding that there is no admission stage in the appeal in the trial court is an erroneous assumption. You look into the CPC. The CPC clearly says under Order 41, Rule 9, Order 41, Rule 9. Above that, there is a heading. That heading should answer this question. What is that heading? Procedure on admission of appeal. Above the Order 41, Rule 9, you have a heading. Procedure on admission of appeal. Right? Now the question is, in the trial court, whether an appeal could be dismissed without admitting it. The answer to that is found here. power to dismiss the appeal, 11, without sending notice to the lower court. Then 11.4, that should put an end to all. Where an appellate court, not being the high court, that is the question, not being the high court,
yes,
dismisses an appeal under subrule 1, that is without admitting the appeal, it shall deliver a judgment recording in brief its grounds for doing so, and the decree shall be drawn up in accordance with the judgment. In the high court, you see, when a case comes up for admission, you argue, judge is not inclined to admit, he says no ground, dismissed. Such an order the lower court, lower appellate court, cannot pass. That's what they are saying. Where an appellate court, not being the high court, dismisses an appeal under subrule 1, that is at the stage of admission, it shall deliver a judgment recording in brief the grounds for doing so, and a decree shall be drawn up in accordance with the judgment. Therefore, CPC do not make any difference between the High Court, the Supreme Court, and the trial court. The only difference it makes is if the trial court is dismissing the appeal on the ground that there is no ground at the stage of admission, you have to give reasons, because that could be seen by the High Court in an appeal. As far as the High Court is concerned, no such obligation is there, because they are here. They can dismiss it as no grounds. And that's why people think a judge, job of a judge is very easy. All that you say is no ground, dismiss. That's all.
Fine, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, the next question is, can the trial court mold the relief even without an IA and decree the suit?
Yes, it has the power.
Sir, what's the difference between setting aside an order and quashing an order?
Setting aside an order is reference to judgment and decree and ordinary orders. Quashing is by a writ. When you are exercising the writ jurisdiction, the High Court quashes an order. It is a legal terminology which is closely connected with issue of writs. Setting aside a judgment and decree is what normally courts do. An appellate court, a higher court, will set aside a judgment and decree of the trial.
Can an appeal lie against two IAs as passed from the trial court simultaneously?
That's what your people are doing it. There's no law. You have your own procedure. When they said 115 is not maintainable, you have converted into 226, and in a writ petition, you will be challenging four orders.
I think this is one general question, sir. Please enlighten us on obtaining direction for speedy disposal from High Court for a case pending in lower court.
That's what I said it. Very easy to issue direction. Between the trial court and the lawyers have to do it. And I have told you how they conduct themselves. If you follow the civil procedure court, no direction is required. If you are not following the procedure, the direction is also of no use.
So the questions, by the end of this thing, questions are increasing. One or two, sir?
If you don't know. I don't
know. Okay. Sir, execution petition filed by another court in original jurisdiction. Can execution petition can attach the immovable property to give notice to?
See, at the time of attaching a property before judgment, the court which has the jurisdiction to entertain the suit has the jurisdiction to attach a property which is within the jurisdiction of other courts. That is attachment before judgment. But after the judgment is done, if the decree is to be executed and the attached property is to be brought to sale, that property should be within the jurisdiction of the court where the property is situated. Therefore, you should seek a transfer of the decree to that particular court, and through that court, you have to execute the decree.
So can the court frame additional issues at the time of judgment without giving an opportunity to parties to lead evidence to that effect?
Court has the power to frame an additional issue at the time of writing the judgment. But once an additional issue is framed, principles of natural justice requires and demands that the case should be posted again for hearing, that additional issue is to be brought to the notice of the parties and the lawyers, and must find out whether they want to lead any evidence in respect to those issues. And if there is no evidence, at least they should be heard in the matter, and then it should be passed. without bringing it to the notice of the parties, if an additional issue is framed and decided, the aggrieved person has a right to challenge it on the short ground, that finding will go.
Thank you, sir. Two more questions, sir, and then we'll wind up. In case of appeal, in case of an appeal pending, whether aggrieved party in execution can file application for review of the judgment?
Once he has preferred an appeal, there is no question of review.
Okay. Sir, when an advocate doesn't mark the documents produced in the original suit due to his or her inadvertence, and a judgment is passed without considering those documents, which against such party, can he seek the appellate court to consider those documents in an appeal while deciding the case?
That's what I referred to you.
Sir.
Appellate court has a jurisdiction to receive additional evidence. That is there's a case where court refused to admit. Here the party has produced it, his lawyer, an officer of the court did not do his job properly. Certainly that should also be a ground for the appellate court to entertain additional evidence.
Thank you so much, sir. Before I wind up the question and answer session, the takeaway for the day is that appeal is not a mere procedure. It's a statutory right. Unless the statute provides, there is no question of appeal. Once the statute provides, it becomes vested in the litigant. Of course, the appeal can only be taken away by the statute. The final takeaway is that in law, there is only one judgment and decree. Despite the several appeals that lie in law, there is only one judgment and one decree. Mere filing an appeal does not stay in order or execution. With these summing up, I profusely thank Justice N. Kumar for enlightening us all these 9 days. Even as an academician, though not practicing now, I'm enriched by your presentation, sir. Thank you so much. Over to you, Varsha.
Thank you, sir, for answering the questions. On behalf of the Karnataka State Bar Council Law Academy, I extend my sincere thanks to Professor Dr. V. Sudesh. Thank you, sir, for your continued support and for making time for us. Moving towards the most awaited segment, I now request Sri Gautam Chand SF, President of the Karnataka State Bar Council Law Academy and allied members of the Karnataka State Bar Council and KSBC Law Academy, to felicitate Honorable Justice N. Kumar as a token of gratitude for having delivered the honorary lecture series.
Thank you so much, Varsha. It's an honor and privilege to felicitate Honorable Mr. Justice N. Kumar Farhand on behalf of Karnataka State Bar Council. I am really feel humbled and privileged to honor Justice N. Kumar. Now, before I proceed, I would like to introduce our members. Mr. Devraj, he is the Karnataka State Bar Council member and chairman of Enrollment Committee. Mr. Harish, Karnataka State Bar Council member, senior member, has come for the, he is elected for the second time. Now, before any delay, may I, sir, with your permission?
Thank you.
See, really, we feel humbled, sir.
ಏರೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಮುಂದೆ ಬಂದಿದೆ
ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ
ಅದೊಂದು ಕೂಡ
Yes, sir. What an astonishing moment it was. I now request Honorable Justice N. Kumar for rendering concluding remarks and sharing your experience about this journey. Over to you, sir.
As I said, first of all, I must thank the Karnataka State Bar Council and its officers for taking interest in the future generation of lawyers. By doing so, they have discharged their obligation, a legal duty, a moral duty to this legal profession. I have been a member of the Bar Council. I was a member of the judiciary. And I am proud of both. But my grievance was, we could be still better off. We should be competing with the best of the bar and the bench. And we should be number one in the country. If that is to be achieved, we should increase our professional approach, both lawyers and judges. And that is possible only when you put your heart and soul into the profession and the job which you are doing. On the side of the judiciary, we have established Karnataka Judicial Academy, and we are striving hard to develop the capabilities of judges. And now I'm glad the Advocate Association also has a law academy. Karnataka State Bar Council also has a state academy. Mere hacking academy is no good. Mere electing office bearers is no good. They must use that opportunity, use that forum, use that platform to enrich the knowledge of the youngsters, the future generation, so that a strong bar would be built. And if there's a strong bar, it is from the bar, the bench comes, and we'll have a strong bench. And I'm sure that the Karnataka State Bar Council and its academy under the chairmanship of Mr. Gautam immediately has taken steps, and it only should be a beginning. This effort should be a continuing effort, as they call it as continuing education programs. Today, everybody needs continuing education programs, and more so the judges and lawyers. And in that direction, if this academy were to work, I have no doubt in my mind, the future generation of lawyers, the future generation of judges would be more capable, able to face the challenges in real life and do justice to the litigant public and general public. So I do hope that all those persons who had the patience to hear me for the last 9 years have not wasted their time, and no one, such functions, such programs would increase, which will also assist and help the law students, the new entrants in the profession, and also persons who are in the profession, because we are in an area of specialization. If somebody is there in the profession for 20 years and has not practiced on the civil side, if they have some time to spend, they will also know what this civil side is, what is the procedural law of the land is, what is Evidence Act, and it will also enrich in whichever field they are practicing. In the end of the day, let me wish all the members of the legal fraternity happy Diwali, happy, better, and prosperous future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I now call upon Sri Gautam Chand SF, President of the KSBC Law Academy, to propose formal vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಶುಭ ಸಂಜೆ. ದೀಪಾವಳಿಯ ಶುಭಾಶಯಗಳು. ಇವತ್ತು ನಿಜಕ್ಕೂ ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಕೀಲ ಪರಿಷತ್ತಿನ ಇತಿಹಾಸದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವೊಂದು ಹೊಸ ಅಧ್ಯಾಯವನ್ನು ಪ್ರಾರಂಭಿಸಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಕತ್ತಲಿನಿಂದ ಬೆಳಕಿಗೆ, ಅಜ್ಞಾನದಿಂದ ಜ್ಞಾನಕ್ಕೆ, ಗೊಂದಲದಿಂದ ಸ್ಪಷ್ಟತೆಗೆ, ಇದು ದೀಪಾವಳಿಯ ಸಂಕೇತ. ಕಳೆದ 10 ದಿನಗಳಿಂದ ಸನ್ಮಾನ್ಯ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಎನ್ ಕುಮಾರ್ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಕೀಲ ಬಂಧುಗಳಿಗೆ, ಎಷ್ಟೇ 10 ವರ್ಷ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡಿರೋರು ಇರ್ಬೋದು, 20 ವರ್ಷ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ಮಾಡಿರೋರು ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಹಲವಾರು ಗೊಂದಲಗಳು, ಕನ್ಫ್ಯೂಷನ್ಗಳು, ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲದೆ ಇರುವಂತಹ ಹಲವಾರು ವಿಚಾರಗಳನ್ನ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಜರ್ ಕೋಡಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಅವರ ಅಗಾಧ ಅನುಭವ ಮತ್ತು ಆಳವಾದ ಜ್ಞಾನದಿಂದ ಮನದಟ್ಟು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ನ್ಯಾಯಾಂಗ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಇರೋದು ವಕೀಲರಿಗೋಸ್ಕರ ಅಲ್ಲ, ನ್ಯಾಯಾಂಗ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಇರೋದು ಫಾರ್ ಸ್ಪೀಡಿ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್, ಫಾರ್ ದ ನೀಡಿ ಪೀಪಲ್. ಅನ್ಯಾಯಕ್ಕೊಳಗಾದವರಿಗೆ ಸೂಕ್ತ ಸಮಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಸರಿಯಾದ ನ್ಯಾಯವನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸಿಕೊಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಜರ್ ಕೋಡ್ ಇರೋದು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ನಮಗೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ತುಂಬ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಮನದಟ್ಟು ಮಾಡಿಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಕಳೆದ 11 ದಿನಗಳಿಂದ, ಒಟ್ಟು 12 ದಿನಗಳಾಯಿತು, 10 ಸೆಷನ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸತತವಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಅಗಾಧ ಅನುಭವ ಮತ್ತು ಜ್ಞಾನದಿಂದ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಕತ್ತಲಿನಿಂದ ಬೆಳಕಿನಡೆಗೆ ಕರೆದುಕೊಂಡು ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ವಿ ಆರ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ಫೀಲ್ ಎನ್ಲೈಟನ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಎನರ್ಜೈಸ್ಡ್ ಸರ್. ಐ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡ್ ಎ ಹಾರ್ಟ್ ಫೆಲ್ಟ್ ವಾರ್ಮ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ಬಿಹಾಫ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಬಾರ್ ಕೌನ್ಸಿಲ್, ಆನ್ ಬಿಹಾಫ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಬಾರ್ ಕೌನ್ಸಿಲ್ ಲಾ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ, ಆನ್ ಬಿಹಾಫ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಲಾ ಫ್ರೆಟರ್ನಿಟಿ, ಎಂಟೈರ್ ಫ್ರೆಟರ್ನಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ಅಡ್ವೊಕೇಟ್ಸ್, ಅಂಡ್ ಆನ್ ಬಿಹಾಫ್ ಆಫ್ ಒನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್, ಐ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡ್ ಅ ವಾರ್ಮ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ಫೀಲ್ ವಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡ್ ಎ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಗ್ರಾಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವಿ ಫೀಲ್ ಗ್ರಾಟಿಫೈಡ್ ಸರ್. ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್, ತುಂಬ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಐ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟೆಂಡ್ ಮೈ ಹಾರ್ಟ್ ಫೆಲ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ದ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂಸ್ಲಿ ಜಾಯಿಂಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಲಾಗ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮೇಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಎ ಗ್ರ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಸಕ್ಸಸ್. ವೆಬಿನಾರ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಬೇಜಾರಾಗುವಂಥ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲೂ ಕೂಡ ಕನಿಷ್ಠ 250 ಜನಗಳು ಸತತವಾಗಿ ಬಂದು ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ನೀವು ಗ್ರ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಸಕ್ಸಸ್ ಮಾಡಿರೋದಕ್ಕೆ ನಿಮ್ಮೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಕೀಲ ಪರಿಷತ್ತಿನ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳನ್ನು ಹೇಳೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟಪಡ್ತೇನೆ. ಅದೇ ಥರ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಯಶಸ್ವಿಯಾಗೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಕಾರಣಕರ್ತರಾದಂಥ ಎಂಟೈರ್ ಟೆಕ್ನಿಕಲ್ ಟೀಮ್, ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಬಾರ್ ಕೌನ್ಸಿಲ್ನ ಸ್ಟಾಫ್, ಹಿರಿಯ ವಕೀಲರು, ಪ್ರಾಂಶುಪಾಲರು, ಪ್ರಾಧ್ಯಾಪಕರು, ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ವಿ ಸುದೇಶ್ ಹಾಗೂ ಇನ್ನೆಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಾನು ಎಲ್ಲರ ಹೆಸರು ತಗೊಂಡ್ರೆ ಇದು ತುಂಬ ಬೆಳೆಯುತ್ತೆ. ದೀಪಾವಳಿಯ ಸಂದರ್ಭ, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ದೀಪಾವಳಿಯನ್ನು ಆಚರಿಸಬೇಕು. ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ತುಂಬ ಹೃದಯದ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು ಮತ್ತು ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು. ನಮ್ಮ ಟೆಕ್ನಿಕಲ್ ಸ್ಟಾಫ್, ನಮ್ಮ ಕಲೀಗ್ಸ್ ಬಯರೆಡ್ಡಿ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ನಮ್ಮ ಚಾಣಕ್ಯ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಶರತ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಅದೇ ಥರ ಸಾಗರ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ತುಂಬ ಕಷ್ಟ ಬಿದ್ದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅಕಸ್ಮಾತ್ ನಾನು ಯಾರಾದರೂ ಅವರ ಹೆಸರನ್ನ ತಗೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದರೆ ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ತಪ್ಪು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಬೇಡಿ. ನಮ್ಮ ಎಲ್ ಕೆ ಅವರು ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಯಶಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಸತತವಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಪಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ವರ್ಷ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಕೀಲ ಪರಿಷತ್ತಿನ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳನ್ನ ಹೇಳ್ತೇನೆ. ಅದೇ ಥರ ನಮ್ಮ ಮಧುಸೂದನ್ ರೆಡ್ಡಿ ಅವರು ಕೂಡ ಸಹಕಾರ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಬೇರೆ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ತುಂಬ ಜನ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಸಹಕಾರ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಪ್ರತ್ಯಕ್ಷವಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತು ಪರೋಕ್ಷವಾಗಿ ಯಾರ್ಯಾರು ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದ ಯಶಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಸಹಕಾರ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅವರಿಗೆಲ್ರಿಗೂ ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ನನ್ನ ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳನ್ನ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ನಾನು 2 ಮಾತನ್ನು ಮುಗಿಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು, ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್.